Welcome to the SETI Institute's weekly colloquium series. My name is Seth Shostak. Adrian Brown asked if I would stand in for him to introduce our speaker. Let me point out that there is a clipboard circulating through the hall. If you're not on our mailing list, which will tell you what the next colloquium is likely to be with very high probability, just put your name and the contact information, the requisite contact information, onto that list. That'll be passed around. Before I introduce our speaker, let me remind you that all these presentations are taped and put online, thanks largely to the efforts of Mr. Lee Lee, who's hiding incognito in the booth there in the back. You can find them all on YouTube. Just look up SETI Institute Talks. Also, we will be routinely listing the title and the subject of upcoming talks on the SETI Institute's webpage. I encourage you to check it out, SETI.org. You can also find write-ups of our latest research on that site and a link to our one-hour weekly science radio program, Big Picture Science. Now, if you don't already know all the stuff that I've just told you, you probably are also unaware that the sun doesn't actually orbit the Earth. Today's speaker is Professor Frank Hsu. He's a theoretical astrophysicist from Berkeley of truly singular eminence and accomplishment. Simply listing Professor Hsu's awards and honors would be a colloquium in its own right. So I won't do that, but you may wish to make it your project for the weekend. He's going to talk about bringing nuclear power to Mars, which is probably an encouraging thing for Matt Damon, who can save himself a lot of boring snoozes while he waits for the solar cells to charge up his vehicle there. I would just like to interject a small personal note here. Frank Hsu has worked in such fields as star formation, where meteors come from, and most memorably for me, why spiral galaxies look like spirals, right? I mean, why don't these massive pinwheels just wind themselves up? They would do that very quickly compared with cosmological time. Well, when Frank was a grad student, mind you, a grad student, he and a colleague, C.C. Lin, proposed that these spiral arms were actually areas of greater density, places, if you will, of greater traffic on the freeway. And stars didn't stay in those areas, they passed through the way you would pass through a congested area on 101. Well, four decades ago, that idea spawned a minor industry as hordes of radio astronomers used big arrays to map out density waves in nearby galaxies. That idea, Frank Hsu's, was keeping researchers employed, including myself, I have to say. All right, I've maundered on long enough. Without further ado, here's Hsu, Frank Hsu.
Thank you, Seth. Well, it's a great pleasure to be back in the Bay Area. It's really much nicer here than San Diego. but anyway, title of today's talk is Bringing Nuclear Power to Mars. And of course, the reason you want to bring nuclear power is because you want to bring people to Mars, okay? So I'll focus on that. I'll just mention that Elon Musk has commented that he wants to die on Mars, just not on impact, okay? So since all lives matter, part of this talk is just to make sure as few people die on Mars, either landing or afterwards. This is a work done by a team of people who are mostly astronomers, and we've now decided our work has proceeded far enough so that we should try to really commercialize it as part of the approach to solving climate change. And we call ourselves Astron Solutions Corporation. So focuses that it's a lot of astronomers. Some of you may know some of the people listed down here. And we're focusing on what we think are solutions. So you have to solve problems to get solutions to these problems. In molten salt, which is what we use, it's important to do experiments because a lot of the technology and the knowledge is really no longer well-known or well-developed, so you have to do experiments for a lot of them. And we do a variety of experiments from laboratory test tube scale to bench top models to actual pilot equipment. Here's a cubical core module that we built for nuclear reactors out of graphitic materials and carbon fiber, reinforced carbon kind of materials, for reasons that we'll talk about now. We try to use as few, as little metal as possible, and I'll explain why. And we've now built or plan to build spherical ones without any metal at all, for reasons that will become clear. We also have another project where we use molten salt to turn biomass into biofuels. We do in 1 minute what it took nature 100 million years to do, okay? And that's approach to renewable power, all right? And the scale of the equipment there is similar to what you would like to build for nuclear reactors. We have one simple criteria. Every piece of equipment that we build must be transportable on trucks, okay? So you can mass produce them. Every single piece of equipment, which is one of a kind here, was transported to the site on trucks. So, you know, it'll fit in a moderate-sized room. All right. So here is where you can think of the reactor, where heat is added by nuclear reactions. In this case, it's just a test sort of piece of equipment, so we just added by electricity. Then it's pumped up by a pump, which whirls and centrifugally flings the salt up to where you transfer heat, that heat, to for other purposes. In this case, we want to add more heat, but in the nuclear reactor case, you want to take the heat from the nuclear reactions and transfer it to something else, a second salt where you process it. The part that you doesn't participate in that processing comes back into the nuclear reactor, but a piece of it goes to do whatever you want to do. It could be generating electricity. In this case, it's to turn biomass into biofuels, and that requires chemistry, okay, of various kinds, which involves partially cleaning the salt after it's had these reactions. You have products that you don't want, and so you will need to clean it. So you do it in here, and you may need solvents, okay? In our case, it's mostly water to wash the salt and often to recover it. Anyway, so this is a general kind of things that you need to worry about when you deal with molten salt. So this is the outline of the talk that I want to give to you. We'll have a preview where I'll just explain an outline without explaining any of the details, how one plans to bring nuclear power to Mars. And I think of this as a second kind of SETI, where one is seeding extraterrestrial intelligence. We're taking terrestrial intelligence from the Earth and seeding it outside the Earth, okay? So that's also kind of a SETI. I'll just talk about nuclear power in that context without explaining it. And then we'll do a SWOT analysis. SWOT is business speak for analyzing the strengths, weaknesses, opportunity, and threats of old versus nuclear power. And I try to skip through this as quickly as I can and just refer you, if you want details, to additional videos that you can find on YouTube, okay, that have been made here at the website information. And then I'll talk about the design of what's called two-fluid molten salt breeder reactor. I'll skip this quickly, through this quickly, to focus on the part that mostly deals with Mars. Whenever you talk about nuclear power, there are four issues you must address, and they are four S's. The first and most important is safety. You want to make sure that accidents do not produce environmental disasters. The second is sustainability. That is, today, the way we use nuclear power and much of the problems with it is that we only use 1% of the actual fuel content. We try to throw away 99%. Nobody's good at throwing away 99%. It's kind of crazy to throw away 99%. So we want to have new nuclear, which uses essentially 100% of the fuel and end up with essentially zero waste. Okay? Then we want security. People often associate nuclear power with nuclear weapons. I want to convince you that that association is false, but nevertheless, what are the precautions that one can take so that nuclear reactors are incapable of producing weapons, nuclear weapons. So that's security. And then finally, the final S is one with the dollar sign, superiority. And that is ultimately it has to be cost effective, otherwise nobody will use it. So you have to be able to beat fossil fuels if that's what you want to replace, okay? And that's not easy with fossil fuels being so cheap today, but I'll explain why we think this is possible. Then I'll talk about take-home messages, and I'll begin with a reprise of this preview. So after we've understood nuclear reactors, we'll come back and see what issues, you know, we have when we have certain requirements up here. And then I'll talk about the advantage of thorium breeder reactors, okay? And that is a third kind of SETI. That is, we want these reactors not only to be used on Mars, and hopefully NASA will help build them, but in fact, we want to use them on Earth. That's a spin-off application. And the goal here is to save existing terrestrial intelligence. What little there is of us, okay? It's worth saving, and so that's a third kind of SETI. Okay, so with that preview, let's move on to the topic of bringing nuclear power to Mars. Okay, so when people talk about traveling to Mars, the first thing that you learn, if you go beyond, you know, just simple-minded ideas, is what's called the Holmann transfer orbit. And many of you may know about this, but I'll just go through a review of for those people who haven't heard of this. So this is a conventional approach. It's actually easier to get to Mars than you might think, because the sun, the Earth is already going around the sun at 30 kilometers per second. Obviously, that's not enough to escape from the solar system. The sun's gravity bends it into a circular orbit. The Earth is almost on a circular orbit. So when you're in low Earth orbit, of course, you're still gravitationally bound to the Earth. So you would like to at least put it in orbit around here. But that, of course, doesn't get you away, doesn't get you to Mars. To get to Mars, you have to add 3 kilometers per second to this speed of 30, okay? So about 10%. That will put you into a elliptical orbit, which will intersect the orbit of Mars. This is the minimum elliptical orbit in the sense that this elliptical orbit, if you didn't do anything over here, would fall back in and, of course, come back here. So Mars is going at 24 kilometers per second. And to get into Mars's orbit, you need another 2.5 kilometers per second. So you need to add 3 here, and you need to add 2 here in the direction. And then you'll go around the same orbit as Mars. And then you have plenty of time to get down to Mars. So how long does this take? This is a minimum energy orbit, the minimum amount of fuel. If you were to, you know, to impulsively add 3 kilometers per second to begin with, and then 2.5 at the end of the trip. Okay, so it takes roughly 259 days. It's not quite that. There's some variation, because Mars is actually on an elliptical orbit rather than a circular orbit. So this is an approximation that Mars is also on circular orbit. But roughly 259 days, plus or minus a month or two, the spaceship will be at the same distance, at aphelion, on the Mars circle. And so if you add 2.5, you'll be on the same orbit as Mars. And then you have time to drop down to the surface of Mars. Now, you can't immediately come back, because if you came back, namely you didn't do anything, you would go back on this orbit, and it would take you another 259 days, but the Earth won't be here, because that's not 1 year. It will have gone around 365, and then plus, you know, twice times 259, so it'll probably be over here. That's no good. So you have to wait until the Earth is in the right position again, just as you do over here. You can only launch when Mars, at this point, is over here, and then it arrives here at 259 days. You have to wait. How long do you have to wait? 459 days. That's why, you know, Matt Damon had so much problem, right? You can immediately come back, right? So that's it. So if you add, you know, these 259 plus 459, it's getting close to 1,000 days, or almost 3 years, maybe 2.5 years or so, to come back to Earth. Fortunately, the Earth has a dense atmosphere, so it's easy to re-enter if you come in just by the drag of the Earth's atmosphere. So that's what is conventionally done. And now I want to consider an unconventional approach if we have nuclear rockets instead of chemical rockets, okay? So here's rocket science. Everybody thinks rocket science is immensely difficult. It's not. Rocket engineering is immensely difficult, but rocket science is really simple. Just conservation of momentum, okay? You're adding velocity in increments where you're basically going in that short space of time and space in straight lines. So you want to increase the momentum of the rocket, which has a mass, Vm, and a speed in that short segment of V. You want to change that by throwing stuff out the back. So you're losing pieces of the rocket, so the change in mass is negative, and minus dm is positive, so that'll propel your rocket in the direction you want to go. You throw out that material at some speed, delta V, relative to the rocket, but that's not the speed that matters. It's relative to the sun, which is almost fixed. So you have to subtract off the speed that the rocket is going at, okay? That's in the fixed frame. So that's how much momentum you gain, okay? And if you regard this as a differential equation, those of you who have taken calculus will know how to solve this equation, and you can calculate what is the added speed after you eject a certain amount. So if I have an initial mass, mi, and a final mass, which is a little bit smaller, I take the natural logarithm of that and multiply by delta v. That would be the added speed. Now, typically, people think of that as really just an impulse, okay? So that's why in science fiction movies, you see they're only turning on the rocket in the beginning, and then the guy's tremendous G-forces, right? Oh, everybody's face gets distorted. That's not actually good if you want to send a lot of equipment. That's big, okay? That'll tear apart your equipment. So actually, we want to do it in a more steady way if you want a lot of equipment to be sent, okay? So let me see what happened here. So, the important thing is if you use a nuclear rocket and the delta V is the fission products, the fission fragments coming apart instead of chemical reaction causing gas molecules to expand apart and giving you the propellant, if you use fission fragments directly, if you had some way to do it, those fission fragments would come out at 13,000 kilometers per second. And that's roughly 3,000 times larger than any chemical propellant, okay? Now, 13,000 kilometers per second, how fast is that? If you can make a bend in a circle to orbit the Earth, it would circle the Earth every 2 seconds. What can we do with chemical rockets? Those of you who are my age know that when the Russians sent up Sputnik, it took 90 minutes. To go around the Earth, okay? And went outside and looked for this darn thing. So that's roughly this factor of 3,000, 2 seconds compared to 90 minutes. Okay, and that's just this indication of how much more powerful nuclear energy is than chemical energy. Another way to express this is that nuclear energy is roughly 2 million times more powerful than the most powerful chemical propellant, but if you add the fact that you have to bring your own oxygen, it's actually 8 or 9 times per gram or per kilogram more powerful. So if you take the square root of that to convert energy to velocity, you get roughly 3,000 times more. Okay, so that's the difference. Now, if you were just to use that difference to go faster instead of taking 6 months to get to Mars, you could get there in 2 weeks. Elon Musk should be very happy with that, okay? Spend less time. But, as I said, the first trip, you probably want to send people there to make it more comfortable for other people. So you want to send colonists, and that requires a lot of material. So there, it's a different criterion, okay? And here's what I think you would want to do. First of all, the only thing you're going to eject out are fission products, okay? And so fission products is just a minor fraction of the mass of the total. So this is very close to one. And those of you who know expansion know that you can expand for the small amount of fission products, and you get a roughly linear relation between the V and the 13,000 kilometers per second. So it's mass of the fission products over the final mass, which is the payload. So the payload is everything. Even if you have organic waste, wastewater, you don't want to eject that. That's going to be very valuable on Mars, okay? So you want to keep it on board, as Matt Damon showed, okay? And only eject the fission products. So moreover, if you want to send something big, let's say the space station, you know, you can't have huge G-forces that would tear this thing apart. The only way we get this in space is bringing it up in little pieces and assembling it out there. You don't want to tear this thing apart. So you want to do it gradually rather than impulsively. And so you just have the nuclear reactor on all the time. It's powerful, less powerful than the chemical rockets for brief periods of time, but over the period of the trip, it's much more energy, okay? So let's consider a simple example. The safest way to get to Mars is actually just to throw it out in the tangential direction. So if you're on the board of the space station, you know, you just tell the commander, keep the sun on your left always, okay? And you just go around. And what will happen is that you'll gradually spiral out. You can think of it as putting it on one circular orbit after another until you reach Mars's orbit, right? And that's, how long would that take? Okay, and it would take 2.24 years, so much longer, appreciably longer than this 259 days. But for each ton of payload to Mars, you would only need 1 megawatt thermal of power from your nuclear reactor. You see, this mass that you spend, you can calculate how much energy that is. And for this kind of orbit, each ton of payload. So that's easy thing to remember. That's why I chose these numbers, okay? So for example, the International Space Station has a mass of 420 tons. So you would need 420 megawatt of thermal power on a nuclear reactor, which we'll say is a two-fluid molten salt reactor on board. This won't mean anything to you right now, but we'll see what it means later, with a sterile blanket salt, so it's not a breeder, it's not a thorium breeder, to give the excess neutrons for a guide to ion propulsion. So what happens in outline, you have a nuclear reactor, let's say here, and it gives, in addition to neutrons, it gives excess neutrons, which is usually used to breed extra fuel, but in this case, you just send it out along guide tubes. And people know how to build these things out of nickel on glass. Okay, so that you send it out here, and then you impact some uranium-233, which is your fuel, and it comes out this way. Of course, half of it, on average, will go into the material, and a few millimeters will be stopped. So only half of it is useful. Okay, and that's all I did. And you don't want pure uranium-233. You want it in a form, as we'll see, which is a salt, uranium fluoride, UF4, which is over here. Okay, and uranium fluoride at the temperatures of outer space, or even at room temperature, is a solid. It's a green solid. So I always tell this to anti-nuclear people, yes, this is very green. Okay, it's a very green fuel, right? So you throw it out, that was 1,300 kilometers per second. Now, 1,300 kilometers per second is not in danger of staying in orbit around the Earth. It's not in danger of staying in the solar system. It will escape the solar system. It will escape the galaxy, okay? So it's just gone. Don't worry about pollution, okay? It's not coming back to Earth. It's not going to stay in the solar system. It's just gone. In fact, it's a way of signaling extraterrestrial intelligence, if you like, that you have intelligence, okay? See, if you see fission fragments, you know, flying past you at these tremendous speeds, well, somebody's got a nuclear power rocket somewhere, okay? So how much fuel do you need? And the answer is down here. You would need 0.36 ton of uranium-233 for this amount of power spent over 2.24 years. So look, you only need 0.36 ton to propel 420 tons to Mars. If you know anything about rocketry, you know that's a tremendous ratio, okay? That's what you need if you want to have a space station. So now you're not talking about one or two guys or a few tourists. You're talking about a whole colony of people. When they get there, you want the nuclear reactor to support their activities on Earth. So you want to parachute them down. You want the nuclear, space station itself to build habitats for them. You might want solar panels there, okay? But the main source of power is going to be the nuclear reactor and its components. You can't land all that weight, so you have to send it down in pieces because the air is so thin, okay? And you can't do that with this reactor, all right? The nuclear reactor, as you'll see, can be disassembled. It's mostly carbon fiber, reinforced carbon, very strong material. We build Boeing 787 out of this kind of stuff today. And you need to send lots of salt down there. Well, these fluoride salts are very stable things. They're undamageable. So, you know, you can just send it down in small packages. You don't want to send it down in one big package because that's a nuclear bomb, okay? You've got to send it down in small packages so it's not going to explode. Okay, so let me now talk about the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats of old versus a new nuclear fission. We're talking about fission reactions, not fusion, okay? So fission, to initiate fission reactions, you need neutrons, which are neutral particles. So they can enter a nucleus without any repulsion because they have no electric charge. If you want nuclei to interact by charged particles, as in fusion, then you've got to overcome the Coulomb repulsion. That's done inside the center of the sun, but the center of the sun is at 10 million degrees Celsius, okay? If you want to do it on Earth, you need to do it at 100 million degrees Celsius. That's very difficult because no metal can hold that fission. You might do it at room temperature, you can do it at 1,000 Celsius, but you can build metal containers. With fusion, you can't. You got to hold it in with magnetic fields or lasers. All of those are unstable, okay? And that's why fusion is so difficult, and we have not even proven break-even. Even if we prove break-even, it's going to be hard before we have fusion as a commercial reactor that will give power whenever we need it. Okay, so we're talking about fission. Okay, so nuclear fission, in brief, is the following. Nature made very big nuclei in supernovae, which are very neutron-rich. Okay, the nucleus have lots of neutrons. And if they get big enough and have enough neutrons, in particular if they have an odd number of neutrons, then they can be forced to have fission reaction by adding an extra neutron, and then it will split into two fission products, which will come apart at these tremendous speeds of a roughly average of 13,000 kilometers per second. Now, why is an odd number of neutrons important? It's because of something in quantum mechanics, which says if you have an odd neutron, there must be one that's unpaired. The others are paired. But because you have an odd number, at least one of them must be unpaired. And if you send in a neutron with the opposite spin, so one of them is spinning this way, one of them is spinning this way, then even if it comes in very slowly, when it's absorbed, you get an extra 1.5 MeV. And that's enough to vibrate this thing apart. Once this thing's apart, the electric repulsion will just come blasting out the nuclei and leaving the electron cloud behind. So these are ions coming out, okay, positively charged ions that are coming out. And these fragments typically will have more neutrons than they like on the periodic table. So they will spit out another 2 or 3 neutrons. These nuclei are typically made in supernovae in astronomy, where you first make a neutron star, which by its very name tells you you have lots of neutrons around. So some of this outer material has neutron-rich stuff, and that's what we use on Earth in fission reactors. So uranium is such a nucleus, but it has to be 235 because the number of protons is even. So since the number of protons plus neutrons is odd, 235, it must be an odd number neutron. And you can see from here that it's only 0.7% of natural uranium. So when I said today nuclear reactors only use 1%, that's the value, okay? We're only using the uranium 237, which is 0.7%. The rest of it, which is uranium-238, is 99.3% of uranium. Now you get a little bit of plutonium by adding a neutron to this, uranium-238, which will turn into uranium-239, and that will have too many neutrons, so two of them will decay and become protons, and you get plutonium-239. Plutonium-239 is an odd one, and so that's capable of also fissioning. But typically, you will only add to this 0.7% another 0.3%. So that's the origin of this 1%. We use 1%. The rest of it, you're not using. You're trying to throw it away. Nobody's been successful in doing that very well, and that's why we have a lot of the problems we have. Now, another way to get a uranium that's odd is to take thorium, which has only one stable isotope, which is 232. That's even in protons, even in neutrons. But if you add a neutron to this, it becomes odd in neutrons, becomes thorium-233, two of them would decay, and you will get uranium-233. Okay, and this cycle is what people are talking about when they say using thorium as a fuel. Thorium itself is not fissionable, but if when it turns into uranium-233, it is fissionable. Now here is a sort of complicated graph that shows if you have these three different kind of fissiles and you add a neutron to them of various kinds of energy, how many neutrons you get out as after it comes apart. And you can see that plutonium is very good if the incoming energy is high, as when they first come out. These are called fast breeders. You see, these are called breeders because your fuel is not fissile. It's fertile. It's capable of becoming fuel if you add neutrons to it. So you can get, you know, in excess of three. So fast reactors make use of this. But the downside is you make more and more plutonium. U-233, in contrast, is above two. You want to be above two because you need one to sustain the chain reaction. You need the others to breed what was not fuel into fuel. So only uranium-233, if you have what are called thermoneutrons, low-energy neutrons, capable of breeding. U-235 is not. Plutonium-239 is not. But U-233 is. Now, there's a probability for these things happening. And it's measured in something that's called a cross section. Okay, and so this is the cross section. It's roughly proportional to the area, the target that you're trying to hit with the neutron as a function of the neutron energy. And all of these things more or less look the same. They go down in energy roughly as e^-1/2 power. That's very easy to understand. You see, a neutron doesn't experience, as I said, long-range forces like electrostatic forces. It only experiences short-range forces. So you have a nucleus. It's only during the time that it's passing through the nucleus that it has a chance to interact. That time for a nucleus of a certain size is inversely proportional to the speed you're going, right? The faster that you go, the less time you spend. And that's exactly what you see here. Speed is proportional to energy to -1/2. So you see this general slope. Now, what is this? This is just three-dimensional pool, okay? If I play pool, those of you who play pool, and you want to make a safe shot into a pack of balls, you stroke it very slowly. It goes in, and it's absorbed by the pack at the expense of jiggling those other balls around. There are many, many ways in which you can jiggle those balls. They're called normal modes. Okay, in three-dimensional pool, it's that way, so you get all these. But that's just a detail, okay? And so all these reactions, whether you're talking about trying to fission uranium-233 or 235 or plutonium, just absorbing it, become uranium-239, okay, which will then become plutonium. They all have this general similar trend. But therefore, you can see that if you want to use fast neutrons, the cross-section is very small. That means to have a critical mass, you have to have a lot of plutonium. And unfortunately, it's too late. Fast reactors cannot be built fast enough to stop climate change. The only reactor that has a chance, I'm biased here, is the reactor that we want to build. Okay? That's the only one. I'm sorry to Bill Gates and other people, but that's the fact. Okay, fast reactors will help, but if you really want to stop climate change, you have to use the stuff down here, okay, which has hot, large cross sections. That's what you need to say. Okay, here's another reason why thorium breeders are more clean than fast breeders. So if you talk about fast breeders, you're trying to take uranium-238 and make plutonium-239. So this is a plot of the number of protons versus the number of neutrons in a nucleus, okay? These are the even ones, these are the even ones in neutrons, and in between, of course, are the odd ones. Okay, uranium is even in protons, so at 238, it's also even in neutrons, so it's not fissionable at low energies. So the only way to make it fissionable is to add a neutron to it, which then will become uranium-239. It's unstable, too many neutrons, so it will beta decay to become neptunium-239. That's in principle fissionable, but it has such a short half-life. To decay again, it will become this before it has a chance to eat a neutron. Now, unfortunately, plutonium-239, even though it has a very big cross-section for fissioning, also has a reasonable size cross-section for just eating another neutron. So 65% of the time, it might fission if you add another neutron, but 35% of the time, it will become plutonium-240, which is useless because it's even in neutrons. So it will stick around and eat another neutron, do this, and you know, various probabilities of doing all this. You got a big mess up here when you try to breed. That's the other difficulty in fast breeder reactors. It's very hard to reuse this stuff, especially if it's a solid. You see, it's not homogeneous. You got stuff that's different in different places. So you get hot spots. That's what it's really bad for accidents causing. So you have to be very careful how you build fast reactors. In contrast, the thorium cycle is relatively clean. Here's thorium-232. If you add a neutron, it'll become this. It quickly decays to protactinium, and then there's some controversy. Will the protactinium eat another neutron and come over here, okay? Or will it continue to decay? And this half-life is not short, it's 4 weeks. There was a famous argument between Fermi and Wigner whether it would become useless and you'd have to waste a neutron going this way before you come up to an odd one, or it would directly. And the molten salt reactor was partially invented to solve this problem. I won't go into the details. Anyway, it becomes uranium-233. This has a nice cross-section for fissioning. Only 8% of the time, not 35% like here, would it go over to become here. If you go down over here, you do have some leakage. Then you have to wait until you get another neutron that produces a fissionable thing. So the leakage this way is very small. Okay. In fact, this has very small cross-section for doing anything. So mostly, it dead ends here. If it does go beyond here a little bit, you'll go this way, eventually to end up with plutonium-238, okay? And plutonium-238 is very useful for space travel, as we'll see, as Matt Damon found when he dug up the radiothermal isotope generator that saved his life. Okay? That's what's used in the Mars rover and to send spacecraft to the outer solar system. We'll see that thorium is a very good way to make plutonium-238. Now, weapons resistance is gotten this way. Sometimes, if you have a fast neutron, you can come in with one neutron and knock out two neutrons. So now you've lost a neutron, but it's still thorium, so it'll become thorium-231. This sticks around only for a very short period of time, so beta decay to protactium-231, which sticks around long enough so it almost certainly become protactium-232. And we'll end up over here as uranium-232. Uranium-232 is a weapons deterrent because it emits gamma rays. And gamma rays are so energetic and so piercing that if you try to assemble a bomb with them, as we'll see, it'll kill you in an hour and a half, okay? So that's the weapons deterrent. Here, the weapons deterrent is plutonium-240, okay? Because it is, in some sense, like a prison, you know? The neutron comes over here and it lifts you up so that you can jump over the prison wall and escape as fission fragments. However, occasionally, 35% of the time, you are dumped onto the prison grounds and you can't escape, okay? At least classically. However, as Al Chapo showed, you can always tunnel underneath the prison and escape, okay? And so plutonium-240 has this problem that occasionally will tunnel and will fission and give you these extra neutrons before you're ready if you're trying to build a bomb, and then your bomb explodes before you're ready, right? You get a bust. That's what happened probably in North Korea, okay? They tried to build it. It wasn't very good. The first time it just fizzled, okay? So these are both weapons deterrents. It's nonsense for people to claim that power reactors, if they're built well, will contribute to weapons proliferation. You just have to take a few precautions, and nobody would try to build a bomb with either of these two methods, okay? All right, let's go on. So as from this brief explanation, you can see that there are many reactors type possible. It's literally possible to build thousands of different kinds of reactors, so which one should we choose? Obviously, time is slow. We should choose the best, right? That's what I'm going to tell you. I'm not going to talk about the other 999. I'm just going to tell you about the best possible reactors possible to build. So if you try to build uranium-235, you're trying to throw away 99%. That's very difficult. It makes things very expensive. So we should do breeders, which have basically zero waste. You use 100% of the fuel. You want to slow down neutrons. There are three different ways to do it. One is with protons or hydrogen. One is with heavy hydrogen, that's deuterium. And the other is graphite. We choose graphite because it's compatible with molten salts and fission products. Deuterium heavy water reactors that's built in Canada, very nice reactor. This is the major portion of what is built today is called light water reactors, okay? And there are difficulties with it. Spectrum, so the neutrons that come out, you would like to have a certain spectrum of energy. The nice thing about having low or thermal energies is you need very small amounts of fuel to reach a critical mass, okay? So you need small inventory. If you have fast, you need a large fuel inventory, and as I said, that's not going to save us from climate change. It can contribute, but not within the century, probably, in a significant way. So you'd want something in between, as we'll see, which is graphite. But it also has its limitations. But anyway, that's what we'll choose. Fuel state. So when you want to recycle this stuff, you have to do chemical separation. You know, the stuff that you want, the stuff you don't want, you have to separate them chemically. So if you go to a chemist and you say, look, I give you a choice. The fuel can either be in metal rods or it can be a liquid. What would you recommend? It's a no-brainer, okay? They would say, oh, liquid is much better for recycling. Okay? So that's why you would choose a liquid. Much easier to recycle. Coolant, well, water. Reactors today were built out of the nuclear submarine program. If you're in a submarine What are you going to use a coolant? It's no brainer, right? There's water all around you, so you're going to use water as a coolant. It's salty water, so what? You have a nuclear reactor on board. You can distill any amount of water you want for the reactor, plus have lots left over for this fuel to, for the crew to drink, right? You need that. Just like on Mars, you're going to have to do that. What about oxygen? They're in the submarine for months at a time. They have to breathe oxygen. They electrolyze water, split it into hydrogen and oxygen, let the crew breathe oxygen. You don't want hydrogen on board, so they just throw it overboard, even though it's a very good fuel. I have a nuclear reactor. I don't need this kind of chemical fuel. That's a danger. So that's why we use water today, because nuclear submarine, it's obvious. But it has a disadvantage. You're talking about H2O. So if it touches something very hot, such as if you've had a meltdown, touches the fuel rods, it can generate hydrogen, which is explosive. And that's what caused Fukushima accident. It wasn't nuclear explosion, it was just the hydrogen that was generated when the fuel, metal fuel rods melted, okay, and produced hydrogen. You could use helium, astronomers know, but that's a gas at almost any kind of operating temperature, so it leaves a very bulky equipment, plus helium is very small nuclear, so it gets into the metal and brittles it. It has all sorts of problems, because you use liquid metal, it's not corrosive. Typically, one metal will not corrode another. It has an efficient heat transfer. Some lots of people like to use liquid sodium, but if that touches air, it'll burn. If it, water gets in there, it'll explode. So there are reasons why not to choose liquid metal. Plus, this gives fast reactors. We want epithermal or thermal reactors. We have to choose molten salt. Okay, molten salt is kind of like a universal high-temperature solvent. Okay, it's corrosive. It's a very good solvent, so it's very corrosive. But that has its good side. It has means that an ability to dissolve heavy metals like uranium, plutonium, thorium. It's a liquid at all normal temperatures, so you get very high density, very compact equipment. Most importantly, it has almost no vapor pressure, so you can run the reactor at a gauge pressure. That's an operating pressure relative to atmospheric, which is below atmospheric. That way, if you have a leak, the air blows in, you don't get radioactive gases coming out. That makes equipment much simpler to build. One fluid versus two fluid, this just refers to whether you want to keep the fertile and the fissile separate. The fissile is going to fission and produce fission products, and among those fission products, a lot of them are so-called lanthanides, and you want to keep the thorium, which is very chemically similar to lanthanides, separate from them. Okay? So the fact that thorium is chemically similar to lanthanides, which is used everywhere, they're called rare earths in the semiconductor industry, is why thorium is a byproduct of rare earth mining. Okay? There are lots of thorium available that nobody knows what to do with, but it's a wonderful fuel. So you can get it almost for nothing. Okay, so the circle things are the best combination. Okay, that's the best possible, as we'll see, in terms of safety, sustainability, security, and superiority. So you're driven by logic to what is called the two-fluid molten salt breeder reactor. Now, the first people to talk about this were scientists at Oak Ridge National Laboratory about 60 years ago, okay? And they talked about building this, but they never were able to actually build this reactor. They went down toward a one-fluid design, which makes reprocessing much more complicated, and they never built a breeder. But, so many people think, you know, it's impossible to get patents on this because Oak Ridge thought of everything. Well, you know, that was 60, 70 years ago. It's unlikely that I thought of everything. And so I'm happy to say I was able to introduce enough improvement so that today I hold the two patents in the USA and China and Russia and Japan and France, not so Great Britain. Germany, Deutschland, and Sweden, okay? All right, so, and I hold the patent essentially because I don't want other people to hold the patent and restrict who can use it. I want everyone to use it, okay, if they can. And that's why we're forming this company, to try to teach people how to use this thing for climate change. So here is a two-fluid fuel and coolant molten salt breeder reactor. I can see I'm running very short of time. Anyway, I won't go through all this. Basically, you have a blanket where you have the thorium. You have the core, which is made out of graphite. You can do it in such a way, since it's floating, such that you have a cage, and you only put in enough graphite balls to do the moderation, so it defines a spherical volume. There's all sorts of technical reasons why that's best. Simplest is that it has the least surface area for a given amount of volume, so you need the least amount of critical mass. To start, you just use light water, use fuel. So you get rid of the uranium, you get rid of the fission products. You have plutonium and uranium-230 and other actinides that didn't get burned. You put them into here. You have a reaction. Neutrons are split out. Here you put thorium in the form of thorium fluoride, and it would be turned into uranium-233. It's out here. Eventually, you would like to put it inside the core, but there's a process by which, if you fluorinate this, it becomes UF6. Gas, it naturally bubbles out of here. You then convert it back to UF4. You put it into the graphite core. Okay? Okay. So this just shows that why we want to choose molten fluoride salts is basically that fluoride salts are basically like plasmas, except they're at liquid densities. So it's, you know, the plasma physics dream. It's something that stays together at its own accord, and it's at liquid densities, not these very low densities of normal plasmas. Okay, and you can't use one of them for the same reason that typically if you just use one metal, you don't get very good things. You need to alloy them, okay? So the simplest example of that is you take copper and you add some tin to it, you melt it, they are miscible in each other, they produce alloy browns, which is harder than either of them separately. Similarly, you want to mix these salts, which are, you choose, so that not absorbers of neutrons. You got to be careful with the neutron economy, such that you can melt them at low enough temperatures to be useful for nuclear reactors. So this just goes through, I won't go through this, basically showing that if you have sterile salt, no thorium in with this as a carrier salt, you have lots of room to operate before you get into where it's very hard to have metal containers. But if you want to have enough thorium, it's not so easy, and you need to consider that. For a long time, we thought this was the best salt, but we finally decided after many experiments with different kind of alloys that we should choose a different one. That's this one. So you can see here, you can have enough thorium, but the temperature can be molten at about 680°C. You probably want to run it over here where there is an alloy that Oak Ridge invented that can handle that kind of temperature easily, okay? Or you can do it over here, but then breeding is a little harder. Okay, let me go through here. This is the design. It's basically a whole bunch of pipes that carry the fuel salt. And then the blanket salt that carries the thorium, this carries the uranium, this carries the thorium, is in the spherical shell design. It's completely scalable. How many tubes you put in, how big you want to build this is up to you. This is, if you do heat transfer, you will know that this is the most efficient way to transfer heat in the pipes here to the surroundings. It's called a tube and shell heat exchanger. So you take the heat from the fuel salt to the blanket salt, and then use that. The fuel salt, you just want to run up and down this way, and don't let it cool down, because otherwise you'll get precipitate. You just let it run through this way, cooling it with the blanket salt. Now, you may know you have to keep this fuel salt from heating up if you shut down the reactor, because you still have decay heat, even when you shut down a nuclear reactor. No nuclear reactor has ever had an accident because you failed to shut down. It's because after you shut it down, there's still decay heat. And that, even though it's just a few percent of the full power of the reactor, is enough to destroy anything that relies on chemical means to keep itself in its integrity. So you have to keep that fuel salt clean, even when you have no electricity. So the way we do this is to use the decay heat itself to generate electricity. I'll show you how to do this so that it's impossible to lose all electric power, unless the decay heat is gone. If the decay heat is gone, then you don't have a problem. So that's another key, just having no accidents. You should always use your problem to solve your problem. Then you can guarantee yourself no problem from that sector. If you have some other problem, you have to use something else. I won't go through this showing you the calculation of the So this is whether you can dissolve enough plutonium, and this is a hard one to dissolve. Uranium, pretty easy. But plutonium, these are different kinds of salt mixtures of the kind that I was telling you about. And theoretically, they should follow a straight line. And you see experimentally, they are a straight line when you plot amount of plutonium you can dissolve as plutonium F3 versus something that's inverse of temperature. That's called an Arrhenius diagram for technical reasons. This is one that's of concern here. And we want to dissolve to have enough plutonium to have a critical reaction above 0.569%. So this is 10%, 20%, 30%, 40%, 50%. So it's about here. And you can read off here what the temperature is. You have to be above 962 Kelvin or 689 Celsius. So that's possible. Barely, but it's possible. If we run at 760, it's not going to be a problem, or higher. It's not going to be a problem. Okay. Let me just go through here. I won't go through that one. That's just basically to show you that it's possible to solve the problem that plagued the conversation of Wigner and Fermi. Fermi thought it was not possible to build a thorium-based breeder, and Wigner said, yes, it's possible if you have a molten salt reactor, but you need a little bit more. And what you need more is a big pool, okay? In which case, you see, these are the yields. If you want the S to be as big as possible, so most of it comes out as U-233 rather than U-234. And this is a big number because we have a big pool. And so what power level should you run this nuclear reactor, which we call grape, okay? Well, it turns out, most people don't realize this, you can run a nuclear reactor at any power you like, okay? Fermi, who built the first nuclear reactor, ran it at half a watt, okay? Half a watt is a very safe reactor. Nobody's going to get in trouble. Half a watt, that was just to demonstrate the principle. So here, it's possible to run as high as 500 megawatts. Remember, we need a 420 to propel the space station to Mars. But for reasonable lifetimes of the graphite, maybe 60 megawatts would be better, okay? So I'll just go through that very quickly. Why graphite? Well, graphite is a wonderful material, okay? Basically made out of graphene layers. Stacked on top of each other, perfect graphite. But this is chemically very resilient to anything. The reason is because, of course, carbon has four electrons to bond with each other. So if you look at this diagram, you can see carbon's bonded with every other carbon. So that's a double bond. Once you have a double bond, it's very strong compared to single bond. So very few things can tear this apart. All right? Now you say, but carbon has four electrons, so where's that fourth electron? Well, it's free to roam in the lattice. That's why graphene is such a miracle material for next generation semiconductors and other kinds of things. So lots of people are looking into this. So, but typically, nuclear-grade graphite is not perfect. So it's, you know, not parallel stacks, it's something like this. And you can damage that because a fast neutron can come in here and, you know, knock one of these guys, and then you've got a fast ion tearing through here. So it's going to damage it. But in fact, the first part of the damage is good. It just straightens out these unparalleled layers, and so it starts to shrink. That's good in a nuclear reactor. Shrinking stuff makes tight stuff even tighter. But eventually, it starts making holes of its own, and it expands. So this is how long you can stand. Once it starts to expand beyond its original size, it's beyond engineering basis, you're going to have leaks. The last thing you want in a nuclear reactor is leaks. So this tells you basically how long it can go. Okay, this is just to show that it's nuclear proliferation resistant, basically because the way that you generate uranium-232 and uranium-233 is to act on thorium-232. So it turns out the ratio at which you generate this in the blanket is just ratio of two cross sections over the energy spectrum, and that's 6 × 10⁻⁴. And that, if you have concentration, you try to make a bomb, is enough to kill a person in 1.5 hours. So if you have people trying to steal the stuff, first guy's going to be dead after 1.5 hours. You can't assemble a bomb in 1.5 hours. You're going to kill 1,000 of these guys before a bomb. Even after they assemble it, this gamma rays is really easy to detect. You can use a Geiger counter. If you try to ship it in a port container, you can catch them. So it's impossible. No nation has ever built a bomb out of uranium-233 for this reason, among others. Okay? So we think this is not going to be weapons, made into weapons. I think I'll skip this, except to say that we want to use the decay heat to drive pumps. And how do you do this? Well, if you have heat, it's possible to build nuclear batteries. And that's what the radioisotope generators that NASA sent to the outer solar system is. You have something that creates heat. If you have a hot surface and a cold surface, you conduct heat, but you dope these materials, these semiconductors, typically appropriately, you can actually have a voltage drop which drives a current, and then that can drive pumps. You need very little to drive a pump, and so you just need a cold outer wall. In space or in Mars, this is really cold, so these things are going to run really efficiently. What do you need? Well, you know, here are the possible choices. NASA's built these things out of both these kind of materials. Graphene is in the laboratory the best. So there's no problem, okay? This heat from the pool, it's always a reservoir of heat. It's kept hot by the decay heat. So the first line of defense is you never run out of electricity as long as everything's intact. So you have no Fukushimas possible. Okay, the second line of defense is if something goes wrong, like you lose your coolant, right? Somehow the pool got a leak, developed a leak, it drained the salt out, then you're going to be in trouble. You got to do a core dump. Just like if your computer gets into trouble, you do a core dump. Well, I won't go through this in detail, but basically you drain the fuel salt out of the region where you have problem into dump tanks that are again spherical in shape because they're the strongest kind of things in which you have buffer salt, and that makes it a solid so it can't flow. But the decay heat will eventually bring up the temperature to where the salt will melt, and then it will become completely molten, and then it will start to radiate, make the dump tank hot, which will radiate black body radiation. That rises very quickly with temperature, so you design it so that this thing never exceeds a temperature that can damage reinforced concrete. That means you have to be below about 773 Kelvin. Okay, so you design it. And then the decay heat is always dropping in time, so eventually it will refreeze and just solidify. So you can never have something like Chernobyl, which it escapes into the environment. Let me go to the last line of defense. What's the worst nightmare you can think of? Well, it's, you know, crazy guys take over the plant. They blow up your dump tanks. Well, these dump tanks are 10 centimeters thick, so that's like a heaviest armor in World War II. It's not very easy to break apart, but it, you know, they go smack dab right onto it. They can break it, and then the salt will spill out. Well, if you put a steel plate below the dump tank, and that has enough radiating area, you guarantee that because the surface area of a sphere is always the smallest for a given volume of salt of any geometric shape. So the black body radiation may not, you know, protect your concrete, but it's enough to protect you before the salt is vaporized. So even though you might destroy the plant, the salt is going to become a solid, okay, in 10 seconds or less. So even though your plant might be destroyed in this kind of devastating attack, there will be no large-scale release of radioactivity. So on Mars, you know, you can imagine, you come down with a small space rocket, could do the same thing, but it hits right on. But it's not going to be killing people, you know, destroy the dump tank. Okay, so let me try to finish up, okay? Why is it cheap? It's because with molten salt, you can do heat transfer very efficiently to a form of carbon dioxide such that it's supercritical. In a normal gas turbine, when you burn fuel, the carbon dioxide is a gas. In supercritical carbon dioxide, the CO2 is at a high enough temperature and a pressure so that it loses the distinction between gases and liquids. And in fact, it can expand like a gas to create a flowing fluid, which can drive a turbine. But it has the density almost of that of a liquid, maybe 10 times less, but still much denser than air. So you can imagine if you had a turbine on a jet plane. We all know that these things generate megawatts of power, and they're not very big, you know, it's because gas turbines are, but you know, they have huge intake. Here, you generate more power than the jet airplane, but here's the intake, you know, something you can grab with your hand. This is a meter stick, generates 10 megawatts of power. GE's already built this thing for molten salt, okay? They want to use it for solar thermal. That's not such a great application. We think this is a perfect application. You can imagine the equipment. It's all going to fit in that little space. All right. Huge amounts of power. Okay, this has been studied by many groups, how to do it. I won't go through this. So here's the take-home messages. Okay, let's come back to this Mars colonization. Why would you want to go to Mars? Of course, you want to go just because for the fun of it, right? Why Elon Musk wants to go. But I think ultimately people are going to say, well, you know, we want to see the benefits due for high-tech industries or whatever. Is it possible that we could do that? For that, you need really to have colonists, all right? So here's the things that we had before. And now let me just say here. Uranium-233 is itself radioactive, all right? But there's no uranium-232 in something that you send to Mars. You're not afraid of Mars getting the atomic bomb, right? Or colonists getting the atomic bomb. So you're not going to send them with uranium-232. Surely uranium-233 is easy. It's all alphas and betas, which you can stop with a rubber glove, okay? So the half-life is nice and long. Eventually it decays to stable thallium-235. On the surface, you may want this on the way there, but on the surface, every 230 kilograms of uranium-233, 0.23 tons, will run something for 60 megawatts, which is a small city, okay, for 10 years. After that, colonists are on their own. They better have learned in that 10 years how to get thorium so they can make their own uranium-233. You know, it's very likely the way things are going on Earth, Earth is not going to supply them with. You know, you need to get this. So what are the advantages for having a colony? Well, you got to take advantage of your disadvantages, right? There's lower gravity, so old people will love it there, right? You know, I'm getting shorter all the time. If I go to Mars, I get taller, okay? It has a thin atmosphere, okay? It's easier to build things that are desirable. For example, people talk about space elevators. You know, it's not easy to get things off and up and off the surface of the Earth. Well, people talk about space elevator on the Earth. It's really hard. But Mars is much easier. You can build very tall structures. The highest volcano on Mars, the mountain, is 4 kilometers high. So we know with strong stuff like CFRC pipes, we can build things. Now, of course, you want to build it on the pole because then it doesn't, you know, whip around every 24 hours or so. And then, you know, you can send things directly down the pole. There are other reasons why I think it's actually advantageous to go to Mars. It's also greater thermal efficiency. Those of you who know thermodynamics know that at higher temperatures, you get thermal efficiency. But so does if you expel things at lower temperatures, it's even easier. At absolute zero, everything would be 100% efficient, okay? So you get much greater thermal efficiency. Much easier to build supercritical carbon dioxide systems. You know, the North Pole of Mars and the South Pole is full of carbon dioxide, solid ice, okay? So for all those reasons, they will actually have, for high-tech manufacturing, many advantages over Earth. That might be a technical reason why one would want to go there. So what about thorium? Well, it turns out thorium has a longer time, but it will reach the same end state of decay as uranium-232, which has thallium-238 in the last step decaying to give you a gamma ray. Well, gamma rays are easy to detect, even if it takes thorium, you know, the age of the universe to decay. There's a little bit of this decay going on even today, and it's been mapped. Okay, it's here's high thorium near the North Pole of Mars. That's why now you want to go up there. So you can get access to this. What about water? Water, in fact, is going to be very valuable on Earth, perhaps more valuable than anything else. There's lots of water ice up here. Adrian Brown tells me, you know, you want to dig cores into these to see the record for methane as a sample, whether there was biological activity on Mars in the past. And you can talk to them about that. Another reason to go up here. So anyway, there are many reasons why I think actually the best place to go is, most people would say here, because it's warmer. But you know, it's so cold everywhere on Mars. You're going to need artificial heat. You're going to need artificial light. So why not go up here? It's much better for machines, okay? At least for the first colony. Okay, so I won't go through this, why. What are the advantages here? We can discuss this. But what's the path forward? Everybody knows that nuclear power is in trouble in America. Other people want to build. I think a path could be driven by NASA. The first step is first transparency to open up the understanding of these reactors versus alternatives. They're not well understood. I think we need transparency to explain to the public and the policymakers what are the advantages of these things. Now, China, Russia, Japan, and the European Union, it's now soon going to be the disunion, intends to establish a lunar base, okay? What's the NASA contribution? Well, you know, many people say, we've been there, done that, right? Why would we want to go again? I think it's as to test out a nuclear reactor. I'm not the first guy to think of this. Kirk Sorensen, who popularized the revival of molten salt reactors, was thinking about this back in 2001. Another reason NASA should do it is because of its experience building these nuclear batteries, okay? RTGs. We're in the Galileo room, right? The only reason the Galileo spacecraft got to where it got to was out in the outer solar system was by these nuclear batteries, chemical batteries. You know, I am plugged. I don't have my computer here. If I unplug it, you all know it'll, you know, run out of power in a couple hours. These things stay operating for decades, right? So all the stuff we sent out where you can't rely on sunlight, it's too far away. You have to run on these things. Or, even better, a nuclear reactor. Now, if you build a nuclear reactor, turns out there's a clause in the laws that were passed after Eisenhower talked about atoms for peace, which was to encourage new kinds of nuclear reactors. That is, they exempted research reactors, which they defined with 50% of the power or the products are sold. If you have less than this, then you can sort of fast track NRC regulations. You don't need all this red tape, right? Well, we're not going to be selling this thing. We're going to, you know, supporting life on Moon or life on Mars. Right? This was pointed out by another blogger, Rod Adams. Okay, finally, you know, we always talk about what's the spin-off application of the space program. Of course, everybody knows that it had great impact on microelectronics, right? Miniaturizing microelectronics. Well, here, the spin-off application is we would scale up this version to save civilization on Earth. I can't think of a better application than that. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Frank. We're quite a bit over time, so I'm going to limit this to one question. It's got to be a good one. This woman seems very enthusiastic. I'm giving you a chance to react before the whole audience fissions. So,
hang on. I'm retired, but I used to work for General Electric's Nuclear Energy Division in San Jose. And at the time, I remember learning about the Gulf and Western plant, and I think in Colorado that used the thorium breeder plant. Has there anybody built a commercial power plant using thorium since then? And if not, why, if it's got so many advantages?
Thorium? Okay, so General Electric has in collaboration with Hitachi, has this plan to build a fast breeder. They call it the PRISM, okay, reactor. Which, as I said, is a very fine reactor, but it's not, I don't think, going to come online quickly enough. Thorium could do it. Nobody has ever built a breeder reactor. So many people think that it's only a paper reactor. That's not quite true, because Shippingsport, which was the very first light water reactor, was converted using thorium, using uranium-233, and they proved that it was possible, even with high water as a moderator, which absorbs neutrons, they were able to show you can get greater than one breeding ratio. So even with a relatively dirty reactor like that, I'm sure with a molten salt reactor, it's not a problem to build a breeder reactor. But the U.S., for some reason, after President Carter, decided not to do it, and in fact, you know, for political reasons, Oak Ridge was shut down in its project. In its proposal to do it. So that's why it stopped. Once the U.S. didn't dare go forward, all other nations thought, wow, there must be something wrong with this reactor. The U.S. didn't decide to go forward. But it's really a great reactor. I don't think building the reactor is going to be tough. Okay? Many people don't realize, when Fermi built the first reactor, how long did it take to build the first reactor before we knew anything? Answer is 3 weeks. How good was his workforce? Well, all the men and women, right, who were trained were in the military forces. So the only people he could get was high school dropouts, and they built it in 3 weeks. Now we know everything. It takes us 10 years. There's something wrong with this picture, right?
Great. Okay, well, I want to offer you our usual honorarium here, Frank.
Thank you.
This SETI cup will give you new esteem in the coffee houses of Berkeley, I'm sure. I want to thank Frank Hsu for an extremely provocative talk. Thank you all for coming. Check our website for the next speaker.
I'm sorry, I didn't.